For much of history, the Great Wall was designed to keep foreigners out of China. But in 1784, Philadelphia banker Robert Morris commissioned a ship to sail to China and establish trade and supply our newly formed nation with tea. In the spirit of the Empress of China, we'll cruise down the longest river in Asia, walk the streets of a ghost city, and explore fish and spice markets in preparation for a hairy crab dumpling and a Tao fish head soup. I also sit with friends and sample the diverse ingredients of an authentic Sichuan hot pot. Join me for a very spicy episode from China.
The Great Wall is an enduring symbol of Chinese history and culture. Ironically, what is now an attraction visited by millions of tourists from all over the globe was initially designed to keep people out.
In 1784, Robert Morris and some investors created the first ship, the Empress of China, that came over to open trade to America after the Revolution. Previously, it was strictly controlled by the English fleets.
After the Treaty of Paris in 1783, U.S. ships could no longer trade with the British West Indies, creating a shortage of goods, especially tea, very sought after in the new nation. So Robert Morris, the Philadelphia banker who financed the Revolution, devised a plan to encourage others to pursue trade with China. He hired a small ship and renamed it the Empress of China, to sail around the southern tip of Africa to Canton. On board, he placed a prominent Boston businessman, Samuel Shaw, to negotiate the ship's hold. Animal skins, cotton, pepper, and 30 tons of ginseng, a root that grew wild in North America. The Chinese valued ginseng for its healing powers and were interested in obtaining more of this perennial herb. But the Chinese were determined to permit only a few foreigners into their country, referring to outsiders as foreign devils. So when the ship arrived in Macau, only the captain and Shaw were permitted to be guided onto Canton. There, Shaw traded his cargo for tea, tableware, silk, and spice. The shipment returned to the U.S. in May of 1785, where the Chinese goods brought Robert Morris and his partners an impressive profit of $30,000. Soon, other U.S. merchants were quick to see the value and flooded the market with ginseng. Beijing is the second largest city in China, with almost 21 million people. From Tiananmen Square to the Forbidden City, the country's capital is steeped in history.
In one of Beijing's many fish markets, I met up with Chef Ping from the Peninsula Hotel. Chef, what is this long fish over there? I've never seen it before.
Sea bell. This is very common in Chinese cooking, just steamed or deep fried.
It looks like a belt, huh?
This is called yellow fish, growing in the Yellow River, actually. It's in the Three Gorges.
So much variety of stuff I've never seen. Want to kiss the fork? Maybe a prince comes out. The jellyfish, take a look at it. What do? You just boil it quick?
Yeah, quickly blanch them and shred them.
Like a linguine out of jellyfish.
Yes, very crunchy texture.
A lot of new things I've seen today.
That's a called mantis prawn, be careful.
Like a praying mantis.
Yeah, exactly. This is guida. It's a kind of a bigger clam, guida.
How do it taste?
Usually it's you boil it and peel them and slice them and mix with chive sauce, chive garlic, guida.
This is my friend, Mr. King Crab. Look at him. Have you ever seen a serious king crab like that? Look at that. Only in Beijing, only in China. Look at that. Unbelievable. It looks beautiful. I like it. Very nice.
Thank you.
Xie xie, thank you.
The best area for the crab actually is the Yangtze Lake. Yangtze Lake is close to Shanghai. Uh-huh. That's why people is called Shanghai crab, Shanghai hairy crab, because it's so famous.
Because it's closer to it.
Yes, exactly. And how you pick the crab usually? Hey, Philip?
You make sure the guy is alive and turns himself over. If he's half dead, he won't turn. Look at that.
This is a
it's
good
like
one.
The lobster. You don't move the tail, yes. Don't buy him.
Exactly, exactly. He's going to tie it for you. It's amazing.
So we're going to go back to the Peninsula Hotel with Chef Ping. We're going to make those fantastic crab dumplings, Chef.
They're going to be tasty too.
First of all, we steam the crab upside down, and once you steam it, you release the crab oil and you hold it in the shell. The dough itself is nothing special, just flour and water. And the unique process is how you roll the dough, how you proof the dough, and also how you're using rolling pin to quickly roll the dough pieces. That's a very unique step.
Awesome. Chef, he's done a few of those in these days,
yeah.
Huh?
We have some minced pork gelatin.
You cook down
the stock and make it a gelatin. Ginger is very important because we talk about it as a cooling element. So we need to add a little bit ginger to it to balance off the heat. And also garlic. Yep. That's all we have.
And then the crab?
Usually once you wrap it, always in 12 to 14 fold, make one dumpling.
It's an ancient art. Now to taste the history.
Yes,
go.
Exactly. This is our heritage. This is the female one,
yep.
Right? Let's open up. That's a core.
The core, the fatty part.
That's the most beautiful part.
Yeah, right there. That's where the flavor is. Oh, now I know. I'm going to stay in Beijing here. hang out with you a little longer. So this hairy crab dumplings, I can't wait to try it. Look at it. So I take my dumpling. Put it in there, punch a hole, put a little vinegar in there. Fantastic.
The suckling pig is a very traditional Cantonese for celebrate a special occasion. We select the piglets, then we blanch them quick using the same principle of when we roast the Peking duck, put them in the roasting fork, hanging them and fan them overnight. And the second day, roast them in the Chinese oven. Brush a little bit of oil. Once you start the roaster, you have to be very patient. You try to achieve the crackling, and once you hear the song, you have to turn all the time. That's the key. If you have too much moisture trapped into the skin, after roast, it's gonna be chewy. Skin with sugar.
Oh.
Actually, you can see all different parts of meat. Here is just a skin.
Yeah.
Over here is a skin, fat, and meat.
You know what? Simplicity, great flavors. Those dumplings were to die for. This is unbelievable. Spectacular. From Beijing, my culinary curiosity drew me to the majestic Yangtze River to taste its bounty, in particular, cuisine influenced by the Sichuan peppercorn.
The Yangtze River is the longest river in Asia and the third longest in the world. Passing mountains, gorges, hills, and farmland, the river is an important physical and cultural dividing line that separates North and South China. Scenic areas and dramatic vistas reminiscent of ancient China still remain. Shibosai Temple rises majestically above the water's edge. Perched precariously on the hillside, the Red Pagoda is a jewel of Chinese architecture. One of the most fascinating sites of the Three Gorges area are the suspended coffins at Kutang Gorge. Ancient Chinese believed that the mountains and cliffs were the closest places on earth to paradise. Coffins are suspended 400 feet above the river. Others are located in mountain caves or placed on outcroppings. Fishermen on the Yangtze ply their trade much the way their ancestors did. From long wooden boats called sampans, they lure the fish using hooks and nets. The Yangtze has always been vital to the transport of goods and people into and out of China's interior. But in the past, travel along the river was not easy and often treacherous due to fluctuating water levels and rocks on the riverbed. The ancient custom of river tracking was used to help the boats, called junks, navigate the Yangtze River. In addition to abundant natural beauty and awe-inspiring scenery, visitors to the legendary Yangtze experience the prominent role the river has played in Chinese history and culture.
We here in the heart of Sichuan County, the spice capital of the world, floating down the Yangtze and preparing some authentic recipes that have been cooked for years and years. And to make sure that we have all the ingredients, we're going to go to the market to double check. That's the Wushan market, and you can just feel the essence of all the different peppers, Sichuan peppers, chili peppers, hot peppers. It couldn't get better than that. Amazing. Look how beautiful it's displayed. That's one of my favorites. The mini bok choy, just really quick, just steam it up. He's crisping the skin of the pork belly to make it really, really crispy. And you eat it here with a little hoisin or maybe with sugar. That's corn, the cheap grinds, the old-fashioned way. They use that to make porridge and pancake. And then she falls and lays it on top. Now that looks so innocent. It looks so beautiful. It has more heat than you can possibly appreciate. But it's a lot of flavor along with it as well. Spectacular. A chef's dream to come to a market like that. You come here, you shop, and then you create a menu. Chris, I've never seen this many peppers in my life in one spot like here. So I guess we got everything. Let's go and make those recipes, right?
Yeah.
Chris, yeah. It's going to be fantastic today. You realize years and years I've been dreaming about getting close to the heart of Sichuan cooking.
Yes.
And here, look at it, we have those fantastic spices where we're going to poach the tripe and bitter melon salad. So we take a piece of tripe.
Yeah. Too much.
Okay, cut it down.
Mm-hmm.
A little bit of oil in there. Ginger, garlic. Sichuan peppercorn.
Sichuan peppercorn, yeah.
Whole beans, cinnamon, bay leaf, orange peel. We're going to give it a little bit of a heat to it to get the spices reawoken and get the flavors into it.
A little bit. Cheers, everyone. Soy sauce. A little bit of salt.
I got to taste the marinade. Mm-hmm.
Wow, the Chinese favorite.
Beautiful. In America, you don't ever buy dry raw, so it's always pre-blanched. So if you would make this recipe at home, maybe a half an hour in a slow boil here, because the tripe is completely raw, it'll take about an hour, if not a little bit more. Yeah, it's a very fancy looking cucumber, but it's not.
No, cucumber.
It's a bit of melon. So go ahead, show me what you do next minute.
Okay, it's chopped.
All right.
Yes, very good, chef. A little bit of oil.
A real quick blanch. You just want to get some of the bitter out of it and done. Mm-hmm. The tripe itself doesn't have much flavor. So by putting all the spices into the poaching liquid, makes this a very beautiful dish. Red peppers for color. A little bit of white pepper.
Yeah, sesame oil. Sichuan pepper.
Mm-hmm. A little hot oil.
Yeah, hot oil.
It's not a salad as we call it a salad. It's basically a cold entree. It's served on the side. And when they're played here, played with a chopstick. So simple, mm-hmm. So beautiful, but so much flavor. For those of you who don't know, this is a tao fish that lives here in the Yangtze. We're going to make a very famous soup, which is a tao fish head soup that Chef Chris is going to show me how to do. It has a variety of mushrooms, wood ear, shiitake, enoki, bamboo shoots, and some nice spices into it. Now, what Chef Chris is doing is going to take the filet first that we make for another dish. People here are still very frugal. So you filet the fish, and the head and the tail and bones can be made for the soup, and the rest is for a different dish. There we go. He's going to chop it open so that when it gets cooked, all the flavor can come out of the fish head.
Yeah.
There we go. He now is taking the gill out, and then it goes into the pan.
Yeah.
To get started, you want to get the wok nice and hot. You're going to put some oil in it.
Fish ham.
Looks good already. Cook it on both sides, yeah. Right? A little bit, a little bit, and then we turn it. So we're going to just cook it for a little bit, and then we're going to give it a slight turn. When the fish is nicely, like, slightly roasted on both sides, so the flavor comes out, then you want to take out the extra grease that you needed to fry it in. And now it's getting ready for the rest of the ingredients that go in it. Got to clean the wok quick.
Yeah.
Bamboo,
yeah. Ancient Chinese technique. So the fried fish head rests now while he gets all the other ingredients ready.
Chris, give me a little.
I give you the ginger, yeah. No problem. Here you go, Chris, the ginger. Yeah. All right. And what's interesting with this recipe, the ginger also helps to get this, the fish smell out of it. Ginger, very essential in Chinese cooking. I don't think you find anything without ginger. The Szechuan peppercorn, then the fish heads go in it.
Yeah, fish heads going up.
Oh, yeah.
And we're gonna top it off with water. It's ginger, it's peppercorn, the fish head and the water. Unbelievable flavor. And then when this is start cooking, then he's gonna prep the rest of the ingredients, right?
Yeah.
First, Chris is gonna cut the bamboo. Notice that it doesn't have to be 100% orthodox. It's really more for just the flavor and the looks. Then the shiitake he just cuts in half, and then the carrots is just what we call a blade cut. Again, for color. He's gonna cut some baby leeks, or what they call here, green onion, and a couple of chili peppers. The enoki mushrooms are kind of unique and very colorful, and basically all you're gonna do is you cut the end off and that's it. And then later, all of this goes into the soup that is cooking away. Now he's skimming the impurities off the stock. Look how nice and clean it gets. To make sure the yin and the yang comes out of it. So it's very important. Chinese cooking has a lot of spiritual ways as well, like in this particular soup. It's just not a fish head thrown in the water. And now basically the vegetable we cut earlier, he's thrown it in. Notice how he's adding it carefully into the soup. The most important part of the soup now is the bean curd, or we call it tofu. And this is fresh tofu. Mm-hmm. There's many ways of tofu. There's aged tofu, fresh tofu. Let me try a little bit of this fresh one over here. Oh boy.
It's good, kid.
Very good. Oh yeah. And how do you cut the tofu?
It's cut like this.
Where? There? Right in the soup?
Yeah.
Okay, got you.
It's salt.
When the bean curd floats, it's done. But you want to have a slow simmer on that.
You want the more flavor? You can put a little bit of sesame oil.
So this is your secret,
yeah.
This is your secret trick?
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead. Let me try it.
Yeah, it's my favorite.
Wow.
Good?
Very good. Not good. Very good. Here in China, Ding Ding Hao. Spectacular. Chef Chris and I, what a fantastic dish. Fish head soup right here on the Yangtze.
On the banks of the Yangtze River lies the city of Fengdu, a beautiful and fascinating place to learn about Chinese ghost culture and the afterlife.
The road to hell is often paved with good intentions, but here in Fengdu, the road is also paved with ancient shrines, temples, and terrifying ghost statues.
Dating back over 2,000 years to the Han Dynasty, Fengdu has a long and interesting history. According to Chinese folklore, the dead must undergo three tests before passing into the netherworld. The first test for ghosts is to cross the Nothing to be Done Bridge.
Folklore has it that good people would traverse the bridge unharmed. Bad people went under the bridge in the pond.
The second test is to cross through the ghost torturing path, where the dead report to Yama, the king of hell, for judgment.
Hop, I made it. So far, so good.
The final test to evade hell takes place at the Tianzi Palace, where one must balance on this large stone for 3 minutes.
Well, I made it. I must be doing something right. It must be my good cooking. The next dish is intriguing. Chongqing spicy chicken. Chris and I are going to show you how this is done, right, Chris?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, you need
it's
a fresh chicken.
Yeah, it's all chicken.
So we're chopping it down. Basically, it gets later anywhere between 16 to 32 pieces. It's really easy eating, very popular. The chicken feet use, obviously, for different dishes. Nothing ever gets wasted in China. Ginger and green onions.
Salt.
Salt.
Mm-hmm. Pepper. A little sugar. Yeah.
Little seasoning.
Mm-hmm.
Sherry wine.
Soy sauce.
And then let it sit for 10 minutes for the flavor.
Yeah.
Oil in the pot. It'll be nice and golden brown. Well, this soy sauce helps the color too.
Yeah.
I got you. Ancient Chinese secret, soy sauce.
Yeah.
So it really depends on the heat. But look at that. The chicken is cooked. Now we just put a little oil in our wok. And now comes all the seasoning. Basically, chicken, you could eat it like that, but the flavor comes now with all the different peppers, the garlic, the ginger, a little bit of your broad bean. And then what next? Pepper, pepper, pepper. all the heat. Just one peppercorn?
Yeah.
Nice one?
Oh, the flavor.
There you go. That you got. Oh. When it goes, when it hits the oil, it just comes out. And then the chili. Here we go.
The chicken
back in. Yep.
Well, the chicken. Yep.
Yeah. Sesame seed?
Yeah, sesame seed.
And serve it up. That's it, right?
Yeah, it's okay.
Chris, you maybe made this dish, but you're not going to get it back. It's mine. Ding, ding, how? Spectacular. This is Chongqing, part of the greater Sichuan region, known for the Sichuan peppercorn and an outstanding dish, the hot pot. And I want to show it to you. Hot pot is traditionally enjoyed with family and friends, and the Sichuan peppercorn is a main ingredient of the hot pot. Look how much fun those families have eating it al fresco. So traditionally, friends or families get together, they have a toast first before they start loading up the hot pot.
Kanbei!
You see, the oil's getting hot already?
Oh yeah.
Chef Chris is now loading up the hot pot. Things that are sliced thin, obviously doesn't take any time. Like those potatoes, you put them in there, 1, 2, 3, and they're done. So things that take longer to cook go earlier into the hot pot. So there's a little bit of a science to it. This is the throat of the cow. It's on the inside lining. It's very delicious. The eel is loaded up with electricity. So what happens is they put the mung beans on top so it cannot jump off the plate. That's how fresh it is. The tofu doesn't have flavor on its own, so it absorbs all the flavors in there. That's why it's so beautiful.
Pig's brain.
Very good. There's a sesame oil in front of me that they make themselves. Each one has their own flavor, the seasoning between garlic and MSG.
One of the reasons actually why they put oil, to cool down the food. If you don't really like spicy, vinegar, and then you mix it.
Can I taste it?
Yeah, you can taste it.
Oh yeah. I'm hooked to this lamb breast here. I gotta get another piece. They're so thin cut, they don't take long time. This is a couple hour event. This is not like fast food, you know. That's why usually people hang out for a couple hours, drink a lot of beer, have a lot of fun. And my second piece of lamb breast, I tell you. There's some serious heat in there. Ding, ding, how. Spectacular. There's nothing can beat a hot pot. It does not get better than that. What a way to end this fantastic culinary journey to China. We experienced some fantastic Sichuan cuisine and met some great friends along the way. Proving again that Chinese food is not only diverse, but a true taste of history. Spectacular.
A Taste of History is made possible by Dietz & Watson, premium meats and artisan cheeses. At Dietz & Watson, we're proud to share a passion for great food and American history. Dietz & Watson, expect the best. And by Sandals Resorts, the luxury included vacation where love is all you need. Cookbooks with recipes from today's program, including A Sweet Taste of History, Chef Stabe's richly illustrated book of early American desserts, and DVDs of the show can be found at atasteofhistory.org.